أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الكريم وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. اللهم أخرجنا من ظلمات الوهم وأكرمنا بنور الفهم، وافتح علينا بمعرفة العلم، وسهل أخلاقنا بالحلم، وجعلنا ممن يستمعون القول فيتبعون أحسنه. اللهم اجعل أعمالنا خالصة لوجهك ولا تجعل فيها حظا لغيرك، وصل اللهم على سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين، والحمد لله رب العالمين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. I make dua that everyone's well.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته مولانا.
But I was going to ask if you could hear me, but obviously if you responded, then alhamdulillah, you are hearing me. We were busy with Surah At-Tur, and we ended, I believe, on verse number 31. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct. 31. We must do 31, inshallah.
I'll just read a couple of verses and then we'll continue. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, telling us the speech of the people of Jannah to each other, that they will say, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. بعد أن أقول أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وأقبل بعضهم على بعض يتساءلون قالوا إنا كنا قبل في أهلنا مشفقين فمن الله علينا ووقانا عذاب السموم إنا كنا من قبل ندعوه إنه هو البر الرحيم فذكر فما أنت بنعمة ربك بكاهن ولا مجنون أم يقولون شاعر نتربص به ريب المنون قل تربصوا فإني معكم من المتربصين. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first spoke about, just before this, Allah spoke about a conversation that would happen between the people of Jannah and how they will thank Allah and attribute their ending up in Jannah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Thereafter, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala turned the address to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, telling Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a manner of consolation that turning the address to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Highlighting what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam should do in the face of criticism. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then also responded to those criticisms. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَذَكِّرْ, remind them, remind them. Literally just remind. It's mutlaq, it's general, right? It encompasses, it literally refers to, it's referring to just the people of Mecca. Remind. فَمَا أَنْتَ بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ بِكَاهِنِ وَلَا مَجْنُونَ. So you are not by the favor of your Lord a soothsayer nor a madman. أَمْ يَقُولُونَ شَاعِرْ, or do they say a poet, نَتَرَبَّصُ بِهِ رَيْبَ الْمَنُونَ, with whom they wait for a calamity of time to pass, meaning they wait for him sallallahu alayhi wasallam to pass away. But we discussed this whole idea of رَيْبَ الْمَنُونَ, like referring to or meaning a misfortune. And I think last week I pointed out a lot of the awjuh of balagha, the points of rhetoric in these verses, how, you know, despite the fact that it looks like a simple verse that Allah is asking a question, but there's a lot of rhetoric in these verses that adds to the beauty of these verses, and it adds to the inimitability of the Quran. And that's important because Allah is going to mete out that challenge again, that challenge of bring something like the Quran. Right? And why is that challenge so important? It's important because it's a challenge that the Quran places before human beings. If you say that this Quran is from a human being, then bring something like this Quran. But the reality is that the Quran is inimitable. It cannot be replicated. There cannot be another human speech like it. And one of the reasons for that is the balagha. And that's actually why I highlighted so many of the awjuh of the balagha last week. Right? As Imam al-Busiri says, raddat balaghatuha da'wa mu'aridhiha. The balagha, the rhetoric of the Quran, it is what refutes the claims of those people who oppose the Quran. So he says, Am yaquluna sha'irun natarabbasu bihi rayb al-mamun. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Qul, say, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, meaning tell the people, tell your opponents, tarabbasu. We discussed this word when we spoke about natarabbasu. Natarabbasu, it's the same word essentially. This is the amr form of the word. Yeah, we had tarabbasa yatarabbasu. Tarabbasa yatarabbasu. That's on the fifth bab, but it is the mudari' form of the word. Here we have tafa'al, tafa'ala, tafa'alu. And this is the amr form of the verb. Qul tarabbasu. Say to them, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, tarabbasu, wait. In the plural, referring to all of those people that are opposing you. Tell them, wait, tarabbasu. Fa'inni, for indeed I, ma'akum, I am with you, minal mutarabbisin, from Al-mutarabbisin means those who wait. Qul tarabbasu fa inni ma'akum min al-mutarabbisin. Say to them, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you wait, carry on waiting. You are waiting for a misfortune to befall me, right? So say to them, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wait. Inni ma'akum min al-mutarabbisin. I'm also waiting with you. Meaning you're waiting for calamity to befall me is not something that phases me, is not something that incites fear into me. Why? Because when we spoke about that rayb al-manun, manun meaning time, that the misfortune of time, which is like, which could refer to death, a calamity that must inevitably come upon you, then we as Muslims know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the controller of time. Allah is the one who makes conditions come upon us. So, you know, you can wait for the misfortune of time, but I'm also waiting. You have no control over what that will bring upon me. And so that doesn't incite any fear in me. Now, yeah, I must remind you that these verses come in a context, right? In the context of the people of Makkah casting aspersions upon Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but also in them fearing that his message will come to fruition, and his mission will come to fruition, and people will follow his message, etc. But they would console themselves by saying that things like, you know, let him carry on. He doesn't have any male children to carry on his message, etc. They used to say his abtar, you know, like he said in Inna a'tainaka al-kawthar. The person, Aas ibn Wa'il, laid the accusation against Rasulullah. Nobody's going to follow him after he passes on. So that's another understanding of that verse, that نَتَرَبَّصُ بِهِ رَيْبَ الْمَنُونَ. We are waiting for, you know, the misfortune of time to befall him. Thinking that, you know, with time, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's message will fade away. But I think the fact that we are some 1400 and what 1450 odd years after, you know, the advent of the Nubuwa of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and Islam is still carrying on and shows no sign of dying out. That is a testament to the fact that the mission of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam certainly was complete, and it will reach its it will run its course until the end of time, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. قُلْ تَرَبَّصُوا فَإِنِّي مَعَكُمْ مِنَ الْمُتَرَبِّصِينَ. And now Allah goes on to refute more of the claims. Right? The first two claims that Allah alludes to here and refutes without putting it in a question form was كَاهِن وَلَا مَجْنُون, that they would say he's a soothsayer, that he would say he's a madman. And Allah refutes those. Then Allah mentions the fact that they would say that he is a poet, right? That they're just waiting to die. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refutes that as well. And Allah will refute that in a moment again. Then Allah's question. Yeah, okay. If there's any questions, you can just go ahead and ask. Inshallah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then continues and he says, أَمْ تَأْمُرُهُمْ أَحْلَامُهُمْ بِهَذَا. أَمَرَ يَأْمُرُ, you know, is to command. Right? Yeah, we have it in the feminine form. Yeah, we have it in the feminine form. But why is it in the feminine form? أَمَرَ يَأْمُرُ تَأْمُرُ. What's the fa'il of تَأْمُرُ يَا? The fa'il of tahmuru, oh sorry, ta'muru is ahlamuhum. You can see that as a dhamma. Right? And this is a plural. It's a plural, right? And that's why it is used in feminine form. Now, funnily enough, that year, the word actually means their minds. Am ta'muruhum ahlamuhum bihada. Do their own minds command them bihada? Am, right? Again, it means or, but in a, for istifham, in a questioning sense, right? Am ta'muruhum ahlamuhum? Or do they, ahlamuhum, their minds command them bihada, with this? With what? With the rejection of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, with the aspersions that they lay against him sallallahu alaihi wasallam, with the accusations that they that they level against him sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah is asking that. Do they just think this stuff up with their minds? Do they just make this stuff up? That he's a poet, a soothsayer, that he's a man. Am ta'muruhum ahlamuhum bihada? Am hum qawmun ta'hun? And now Allah turns the question and accusations against them. So first Allah was just responding to accusations that they lay against Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam by posing the question, do they say he's a poet? Do they say he's a, you know, he, first he's not a soothsayer, he's not a madman. Do they say he's a poet? Do their own minds command him with this? Allah's changing the accusation to be against them. Am hum qawmun ta'hun? Am hum, again, am, continuing the questioning, the sequence of questions. Or, but in a questioning sense, هُمْ قَوْمٌ طَاغُونَ. Or, this will be a مُبْتَرَيَة. Or, are they قَوْمٌ, a people? What kind of people? The sifa for people is طَاغُونَ. طَاغُون comes from طَغَى. طَغَى means what? This is the ism al-fa'il. طَاغُونَ. Here we actually have the singular form of طَاغُونَ will be طَاغِن. The root letter is on. Oh, wow. So if I put it in the ismul fa'il form, it would be fa'ilun ta'ghiwun. But we know when we have a weak letter at the end, instead of saying ta'ghiwun, what would we say? We just say طاغين. We call it اسم المنقوص. It falls away. طاغين. And the plural will be طاغون. But what does it mean?
Transgression.
Precisely. It means to طغى means to transgress. So طاغون means those who transgress. What does it mean to transgress? Yes, it means to sin, as somebody put in the comments. But just in a more literal sense, it means to cross boundaries. That's why we use the word transgress, to go beyond what Allah commanded, to go beyond what Allah asked of them. And that's why it's actually munasib. It's suitable in this context, because they transgress the commands of Allah, or they transgress what is correct as well and what is true for what their own minds command them. They know Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is not a kahin. They know he's not a majnoon. They know he's not a sha'ir. His words don't fit the scales of poetry. His speech is unlike their poetry, which they were the best at. He is clearly not a madman, because he's known to be al-Amin. He's known to have the best of character. He's known to have had intelligence throughout his life, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He's known to have been a good business person. He's not a soothsayer. He was never into things like soothsaying, telling people the future. In fact, he's telling them how they should be. That's giving them, the most perfect moral compass. Those are not things that madmen, soothsayers, poets do. So what's Allah showing here? Allah is asking the question, implying thereby that they are the people that transgress, meaning they go beyond the bounds of what is correct, what is commanded by Allah, and they go to what? To what their own minds fashion up, what their own minds command them with. Right? And when we speak about ahlamuhum, yeah, right, you can see the word aql is not used. Because usually we use the word ahlam when we're referring to like dreams, etc. So this is referring to like the spurious thoughts, stuff that they just make, their minds just make up. Not that the true rational faculty that allows them to discern. It's just their own, the machinations of their mind, basically. أَمْ تَأْمُرُهُمْ أَحْلَامُهُمْ بِهَذَا أَمْ هُمْ قَوْمٌ طَاهُونَ أَمْ يَقُولُونَ. Now Allah mentions another accusation that they lay against him. أَمْ يَقُولُونَ. أَمْ يَقُولُونَ. Or do they say? يَقُولُونَ is literally they are saying, but we know when we put it into a question, it will become, are they saying? But because this incident is past tense in relation to us, we translate it as that, right? أَمْ يَقُولُونَ, or do they say? What are they saying? But we know that in accordance with all the previous stuff, these are questions that they said. أَمْ يَقُولُونَ, or do they say, تَقَوَّلَهُ, تَقَوَّلَهُ. What's the verb here? تَقَوَّلَهُ, which verb? Fifth bab, correct. Right? The root letters are, as you know, qaf, waw, lam. Qaf, waw, lam. Here we have taqawwala, yataqawwalu. And what does it mean? It means to make up speech. To make up speech. Am yaquluna taqawwalahu. Or do they say that he made it up, basically? Taqawwalahu. The who is the maf'oolun bihi. What is made up, right? Referring to the Quran. Or do they say that taqawwala is the maadi? Taqawwala, taqawwalu, etc. Who's the fa'il of taqawwala? If you look on the verb, there's nothing on the verb taqawwala, or at the end of it. If you look to the left, bal la yu'minun, there's nothing that can possibly be the fa'il over there. Then we're only left with inside. Inside it is huwa. The huwa referring to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Because this whole passage is about aspersions that the Quraysh made against Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So how do they, the Quraysh, say, meaning the disbelievers from the Quraysh, or do they, the disbelievers from the Quraysh, say, taqawwalahu, he Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam made it up, made it the Quran up. Why I'm saying it like that is just so that you can have all the dhamair accounted for. Because the fa'il here is this wow. That implies whom? It's so funny how that arrow there. Whom? The qawwala inside here is a huwa. And who is also huwa. So there's a whom, huwa, huwa. This one refers to the disbelievers amongst the Quraysh. This one refers to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This one refers to the Quran. Or do they say that he made it up? بَلْ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. Rather, they do not believe. That's a simple part of the verb. Rather, they do not believe. What does بَلْ do? بَلْ negates what came before it. It means rather, but it negates what came before it. And it asserts something else. So what is it negating here? What it's negating is the implication of the question. The question is, did he fabricate it himself? Did he make it up? Right? And so Allah says, Bal. We understand from that Bal already, no, he didn't make it up. Rather, la yu'minun, these people, the people casting aspersions, they just don't believe. They don't have belief that this Quran is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Or they do not want to believe that this Quran is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And to reject that it's from Allah, what must they do? They have to say that it comes from him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They have to say that he made it up. And so this is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responding to that. But how does Allah respond? Allah responds by giving them a challenge. And this is the challenge that I spoke about earlier. That Allah gives in a number of places in the Quran. فَلْيَأْتُوا بِحَدِيثٍ مِثْلِهِ إِنْ كَانُوا صَادِقِينَ فَلْيَأْتُوا. What does that mean?
They will give. Take.
Look at it like this. There's a fa.
So?
Fa means so, right? It shows us that this sentence follows on from what came before. So it's continuing that discourse. So let them do this. Meaning, if what they claim, whatever they claimed before, right? They made all of those accusations against Rasulullah. So in light of those accusations, then let them do something. This lam here is lamul amr. When you have a lam with the sukoon and a present tense verb, then it's lamul amr. What does it do? It changes a, you know, not a second person verb, but the third person and the first person, we usually use it for those. It changes that form of the verb into an amr. Right? So here we have ata ya'ti. Ata ya'ti. Ata ya'ti means what? Ata ya'ti means to? We have it in the comments, mashallah. Ata ya'ti, ata means to come. Ata, when used with the harf bi, as you can see here, bi means to bring. But how do we translate this third person verb? That's correct in the comments. Let them do this, or they should do this. Right? So let them bring, or they should bring. So they should bring, or so let them bring. What should they bring? Let them bring. And if we translate it as bring instead of come, then we don't have to translate the ba. Another way is we can translate it as let them come with. That's a more literal, slightly clumsy translation. But it means, so let them bring. Hadithin mithlihi. What does hadith mean? Yeah, in this context, hadith means a speech. All right. Why? Because the Quran is a speech. The Quran is a speech. Well, our understanding, it's a speech of Allah, kalam of Allah. Now, not to be confused with our usage of this hadith, yeah, and hadith when we refer to the narrations of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, right? That's a different technical term, right? It applies to a different field of study that just literally means that has a technical meaning in that field of study. The literal meaning of hadith just means a speech. And it comes from the root hadatha, for something to occur. But to us, this is the speech of Allah. This is the speech of Allah. فَلْيَأْتُوا بِحَدِيثٍ مِثْلِهِ. So let them bring a speech, مِثْلِهِ. What's the sifa of this hadith? You know already that when you have a word that's nakira, then oftentimes it's explained by a phrase after it. فَلْيَأْتُوا بِحَدِيثٍ مِثْلِهِ. Then let them bring a speech the like of it, or meaning similar to it or like it. And then there's a shart added to them, in kanu sadiqeen, if they are sadiqeen, truthful. Now, we could have put this at the beginning, in kanu sadiqeen, if they are truthful, falyatu bihadithin mithlihi. But when we put this at the end, it actually focuses on the idea that let them do this if they are truthful, implying thereby that they're not truthful. The focus is on that shart that will not be fulfilled, right? And so if they do not fulfill the shart, if Allah says, if they are truthful, then they must do this. So if they don't do that, then they are not truthful. And that's what the verse is saying. Now, here again, this is the challenge of the Quran. Against all of those people that try and claim that the Quran is not through the trend Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made up, the trend. So what is Allah's challenge to that? If you claim any of those things against the Quran, then just bring something like it. Just bring something like it. And as I must have told you before, yes I did, but maybe not everybody was in the class at that time. They did. There were attempts to bring things like the Quran throughout time. Musaylima al-Kadhab, he had attempts to fabricate things like the Quran. How did his surah go now again? He had some others, but the famous one is al-filu mal-fil wa ma'adaraka mal-fil. That a fil is an elephant. But as soon as I started reciting that, what does it make you think about? It makes you think about Surah Qari'ah. He's just simply copying what the Quran has already brought in terms of its structure, in terms of its style, and he's changing it. And what is it? What happens when he changes it? What happens when he changes it? That it loses its beauty, it loses its meaning, it loses its effect, because that style and that, the wording that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used is specific to the meanings that are conveyed there. So the Quran is a combination of words, of rhetoric, of meaning, of morality, of law, of all of those things. It's all bundled in one perfect text. Many people have tried, they've copied things, and then they come up with something that sounds like Quran. Right? It sounds like Quran. But in reality, it's nothing like Quran. It doesn't have the balagha. It doesn't have the depth of meaning. It doesn't have the connectedness. It does not have the harmony of the Quran or anything like that. And throughout time, people have done it. And I told you, what shows this this idea that I alluded to earlier as well of Imam al-Busiri, where he says that the rhetoric of the Quran, it refutes the claims of those that oppose it. There's the famous story of the Arabi, the Bedouin, who tried to imitate the Quran until he got to the verse, وَقِيلَ يَا أَرْضُ بَلَعِي مَاءَكِ وَيَا سَمَاءُ أَقْلِعِي وَغِيضَ الْمَاءُ وَقُضِيَ الْأَمْرُ واستوت على الجودي وقيل بعدا للقوم الظالمين in Surah Hud. And then when he came to that verse, he just gave up. He said, no, no, this is impossible. One can never imitate this. Because he would say that, you know, there's too much balagha in this one verse for it to be human speech. Some would say in the 20-something awjuh of balagha, points of rhetoric in one verse. Others would say up to like 90, and some people would go into hundreds in how they would find awjuh or aspects of rhetoric in a single verse of the Quran. In a single verse of the Quran. And like I told you last week when I was pointing out those awjuh of balagha, is that for us, when we can put one figure of speech in a sentence, then, you know, we think we Shakespeare. But yeah, the Quran is replete with it. And sometimes, you know, to us, it's not always that easy to pick up because we're not proficient in it. But if you go to the books of tafsir that actually detail the awjuh of balagha, that's one way of coming to know them. And another way is, you know, once you learn balagha and then you read the Quran with that eye, then you are able to pick it up. And also you have to read Arabic poetry and stuff like that. And that helps you to understand the beauty of the Quran. Why I mention this, because you may think that, oh, this is a challenge that Allah posed, but nobody actually takes up this challenge. It's something that is not, it's a challenge that is not met because nobody actually attempts it. Right? And so recently, amongst like a online clique of guys that try to attack Islam, etc., there are some of them that try to imitate the Quran, and they made what they call a surah. So we have Surah Qaf. They made up a surah called Fa Qaf. Now they're probably trying to be insulting, but and then what they do after that is they put Arabic sentences together. Right? And they try and copy the rhythm of the Quran as well, just like Musaylimah al-Kadhab did. And this is why I'm bringing it to your attention. You know, at the time that it came out, a number of youth came to me, and some of my own students at the Darul Uloom, etc., and they brought this to me, and they say, yeah, these guys claim that they have brought something like the Quran. So I asked them, okay, do you think that anything that just sounds like the Quran means that it's like the Quran? Certainly not. Find me the balagha in these things. Find me the depth of meaning in these things. This guy's talking nonsense about like materialistic stuff. Find me the moral excellence in this. Find me the precision of word choices in this. Find me the beauty instruction in this. No, they actually, you know, what is a further insult to their own attempt at imitating the Quran is that they had to copy the Quran to try and bring something that sounds like it. They didn't come with anything from their own side, really. Except that what they brought from their own side was deficient. And so we must know that the Quran is miraculous because it is inimitable in a variety of ways. Right? In fact, as we study the Quran more, as we assist the Quran more, as we learn more about the Quran, not with an eye to critique it, but with an eye to see that beauty in the Quran, then we discover more and more miraculous features about the Quran. Like I told you guys before about the structure of the Quran. You know, our mufassirin, most of them used to study the verses atomistically, like individually, and at times they would say, look, this section is connected to that verse in that manner. But then we have a guy like, what's his name now? Raymond Farren, studying the composition of the surah of the Quran. And then he finds beauty in
the miraculous structures in the Quran. I mean, he wasn't even always a Muslim, but he finds this miraculous aspect of the Quran. And then we have people promoting that, like, you know, Sheikh Hamza, Nu'man, etc., bringing to light that beauty that you find in the Quran. And then we actually look with an eye to that kind of structure in the Quran, and we see it, and other people start adding to that discourse as well. But we come across another miraculous aspect of the Quran. Ahmed Zanza, Bismillah.
Yes, Maulana, just a question on that. Do these guys do it to prove themselves wrong, or to prove that the Quran is wrong? You know, do they, sure, the people that you mentioned, do they do it to show that they can't do it?
No, they do maliciously. They do it to try and prove that the Quran can be imitated.
Okay.
And that's why I'm, you know, everybody's on YouTube these days.
Yeah.
Right? From the young to the old, everybody's on YouTube. To come across something like that is very easy. Because like I said, even if you're in those circles of people that do da'wah and stuff like that, right? Get into those debates, you're very likely to come across these guys who made these, you know, attempts at the surah. And for some people, it can like put a moment of doubt there, or shake your iman for a moment, right? Because all that you're comparing is the rhyme scheme sounds like the rhyme scheme of the Quran.
Yeah.
But I think through our learning the Quran, we should have come to know that there's more depth to the Quran than just the rhyme scheme. In fact, the Quran itself at times takes attention away from that. That the attention is on the meaning, the rhetoric, and that's what's inimitable in the Quran. And as I was saying, as we go along, we learn more and more miraculous features of the Quran. For example, the miracle that Quran never, or that modern knowledge, scientific knowledge, whatever types of knowledge, it never contradicts the Quran. Anything that we know definitively or with some level of definitiveness, it never contradicts the Quran. And I discussed that with you when I discussed the scientific miracle of the Quran. That my thing is not that the scientific miracle of the Quran is the fact that the Quran tells a scientific fact, but rather the fact that with the advancement of our knowledge, in every era of advancement of our knowledge, there's a way to interpret the Quran in light of that. Right? It never contradicts. And that is in reality a miracle as well. It's a miracle of knowledge. And so the nature of the miraculous nature of the Quran is multifaceted. Never ever be swayed by somebody that comes to you and tells you something that sounds like the Quran just because of a rhyme scheme that it copied from the Quran, that this is like the Quran in any way. No ways. The Quran is a lot deeper than that. فَلْيَأْتُوا بِحَدِيثٍ مِثْلِهِ إِنْ كَانُوا صَادِقِينَ So let them bring a speech like it if they are truthful. Now Allah goes on. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes on to pose questions at them. But not questions now related to them, to the accusations against Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. It's questions for people to reflect upon and thus come to the conclusion that Allah exists. Right? Come to the conclusion that Allah is supreme. Come to the conclusion that they should submit to this Quran. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says what? أَمْ خُلِقُوا مِنْ غَيْرِ شَيْءٍ أَمْ هُمُ الْخَالِقُونَ I'm first going to translate it for you, right? I don't know if time is going to allow us. But I want to give this a moment, inshallah. If not this week, then next week. Because in these verses, we argue are some of the strongest proofs for people that have doubts in relation to the existence of Allah. Right? And I think it's worth knowing in our time where many people face a crisis of doubt, and it's becoming increasingly common amongst youth. At least from my own anecdotal experience with youth, it's certainly something that is on the rise. And I think it's not just my anecdotal experience. There are studies that people are increasingly finding themselves in doubt, and it's the nature of our time. You know, the nature of our postmodern society is that everything gets deconstructed and people are left with nothing. And thus they start doubting everything. But so in these verses are a powerful remedy to that kind of thinking. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Am khuliqu, khalaqa means to create, right? Khuliqa means, khalaqa is to create, khuliqa is to be created. Perfect, right? So Allah says, Am khuliqu, or were they created? Were they created? Min ghayri shay'in. Min from ghayri shay'in. Literally ghayri means other than. Or we can translate it as other than or not. So were they created from other than a thing, or in better English, were they created from nothing? From nothing. Am humul khaliqoon. Am or humul khaliqoon. Are they al khaliqoon, the creators? Khaliq is the ismul fa'il. Khaliquna plural, because it's referring to all of those who oppose the Quran. Or were they created from nothing? Or are they the creators? Meaning, did they self-create? أَمْ خَلَقُوا السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ أَمْ أُوْ خَلَقُوا. Remember, خَلَقُوا will mean they created. But if you put the أَمْ before it, أُوْ did they create. أَمْ خَلَقُوا أُوْ did they create السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ, the heavens and the earth. Right, that's the end of the question. بَلْ rather لَا يُوْقِنُونَ, they لا يوقنون, do not have yaqeen, they do not have certainty. And it's actually profound there, because certainty means the absence of doubt. Certainty, yaqeen, means the absence of doubt. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Allah says, the crisis, the reason for their wrong thought is because they don't have yaqeen. If they don't have yaqeen, what they have then is necessarily doubt. And this is what people are, you know, scholars are finding to be the problem of our time as well. That people are riddled with doubt. There is no stability. There is no anchorage in belief. Right? In a belief that people hold with conviction. And, you know, they're not spending every day questioning it. Ask youth in schools. Their iman is attacked all the time. Subtly it's attacked. Their beliefs, their morality. And it's the world that we live in. I mean, I was at university not too long ago. It's as if the society values questioning those things all the time. It's as if the society values questioning all of those things that we're supposed to hold with conviction. It values, it venerates questioning those things all the time. Now, yes, Islam values critical thought, but after certain things are established and we have yaqeen in them, we allow ourselves to be convinced in that basis, such that we're not fixated on everyday thinking, does Allah exist, does Allah not exist? No. Allah exists, finished. I know that intuitively. I know that via experience. I know that via reading the Quran. I know that logically. What am I going to do? I'm going to spend my time worshipping Allah in various ways. I'm going to spend my time serving the deen of Allah in various ways. But if I'm constantly riddled with doubts and I'm renewing that doubts within myself, then it causes a type of inaction. It stops me from giving myself to that cause. And that's a big problem. And that's one of the things that feeds into our Muslim in action and, you know, dealing with bigger problems in society. But we live in the age of doubt. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us from it. May Allah make us the people of conviction. May Allah grant us yaqeen and grant our children and their children and our progenies to come. May Allah grant them yaqeen in Him, such that they recognize that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not a reality to be explained, but rather Allah is the explanation of reality. May Allah, as Shaykh Abdul Hakim Murad said, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us. Wa akhiru da'wana an alhamdulillah rabbil alamin wa la muhammad is here. So we'll continue this discussion next week, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Assalamu alaikum wa
rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Tamam, barakallahu fikum jami'an.